good. Very good. Very good. Man, that's can you see me here? Am I good? Can you see me now? Can you hear me now? I'm not gonna have verses there, but we'll read them together. And we'll have an exercise. I'm trying to do this every Friday night. So we'll go through these exercises. These are things that the Holy Spirit is teaching us, and they are things that are helping us as we grow, as we walk with Him. The word that was during the worship, it came to me a little bit about victory. And usually, the Father has always surprised me, okay? He likes to surprise me. So when I expect the least, you know, you have, like, you go to work, it's kind of like a regular day, and it's like things are just exploding. In a good way, you know. Well, sometimes not in a good way, but, you know, it's kind of like the quiet before the storm. But He taught me that His pace of walking with us, it's not according to what we see outside. Did you ever ask yourself why He would come with a pillar of fire in the night? And the cloud, the pillar of cloud during the day for Israel? Because He likes to go contrary to the things that appear. He likes to go the opposite. So if it's cold and dark, He's going to put some fire that has light and warmth. Interesting, right? He is not bound to the way that things are working. You know, so you're thinking, oh, I'm gonna relax and don't have to think. I don't even have to pray too much. I'm okay, you know. I'm challenging and I'm saying you have to learn the pace of the Father, what He wants to do. Some other times you're like so struggling and such a tense situation and I have to get there and I'm late. Wow, what a busy day. And the Lord says, relax. Not even get to do all these things. You don't have to. When you have to, then you don't have to. So the opposite, right? So it's interesting how He's leading us, okay? Man, I have to fix this stuff. You know, lots of times we get into this bondage of legalism. When this thought is coming now, you have to call this person. If you don't call him today, I don't know. I don't think grace is going to stay with you anymore today. You know? And he puts you in a boundary that is almost impossible to keep, right? So that thought itself was a thought that puts you in bondage. And the Lord says, no, just... You will talk to the person. I'll bring the opportunity. Everything is going to be okay. Yeah, so every time this stress and this kind of a must comes in, just relax. Every time relaxation, kind of like, you know, I'm going to take a time off now. You know, it's rest. It's from the Lord. But I want you to be... Let the fire from inside be active, okay? We are never passive. Rest is not passivity, okay? No, it's not. Rest is extreme active. You know how we know that? Because Jesus said, my Father is working, and I'm working like my Father. And last time I read about God is that He entered rest and never came out. Right? The seventh day, God rested. And He didn't say that He came out of in the eighth day. Oh, man, if everything that Jesus did, all those miracles that you cannot write in books, were out of rest, that's the most active rest I ever seen, right? Rest is not passivity. It's not like, no, there's lots of amazing things happening while you are in the rest. That's why, you know, we're praying that, you know, God speak to us even during the sleep. Use us. Oh, there are some testimonies about travel. You know, the Lord took, you know, and in the spirit, in Him, we got different ones of you and of us to travel in different places, to pray for people, to bring salvation, healing. So we are not according to the standards of this world. Okay, so that's not how you have to think. Okay, move in contrary. Okay, all the world kind of goes in, and here it is a weekend, and everybody's thinking, get out of there, just do nothing. And the sons are just watching, in rest, watching. Okay, very important, learn this pace of walking in the Spirit of the Lord. It's awesome. Because you are never taken by surprise then. Jesus was never taken by surprise. You know, the death of his best friend didn't take him by surprise. He knew it was coming. They thought that they announced him. Are you kidding me? It's like, in case you don't know God, let me tell you, let me keep you to the current events. There was an earthquake in Italy. Okay. So there's lots of activity that the Lord is doing and is moving through his body, through his sons. There's lots of the intercession is extremely, extremely active. If you guys are not on the list, I think Michael sent an email about the intercession, which was really deep, really strong, about the intercession of the Son, intercession of Jesus. That's the work of giving life that's happening through all of us. And that's 24 hours. That's absolutely continuous. Okay? So, good. You guys are still here, right? So I'm not sure about you guys, but I'll catch up with you. Okay. So I'm gonna go a little bit through spiritual authority. We had a couple of weeks ago. We talked about authority and we went through different. Verses and some teaching. It was very good. I still the Holy Spirit wants me to go back and talk about that. Authority is absolutely the most important thing of who you are. So the authority comes from identity. Okay, power comes from training. Okay, you get built up in your most holy faith. Yeah, that's power. But authority is who you are. Okay, a son of a king doesn't have to do any exercise, doesn't have to learn how to fight. He has authority. But most of the sons of the kings, they want to have the power too. So they want to be, you know, build up strong, good leaders in army and all this kind of stuff. But it's not related to the authority. The authority is who you are, who are you born as, right? That gives you the authority. Of course, people in the world, they change that into, you know, how much money you have, you know, how much you're worth, how many businesses you have, and how smart you are, but that's not really authority. That's not. that's something that can give you a human position, a status. We call it status, right? That's a status. The status is not authority. And it's as the body of Christ is coming into the right position, you will know that people that have the status have very little authority, definitely not over us. I love to read in the Old Testament about the prophets, you know, Elisha, Elijah. So Elisha was the guy that was telling the Israel, the king of Israel, what his enemy, the king, was saying and was planning. So it's like the guy was saying, okay, tomorrow I'm going to go and attack Israel this way. And this guy would hear it. That's an old guy. It's like never trained in army, right? So he say, okay, send his servant and says, tell the king of Israel, this is where the Syrians will be. And he would go, for sure, that's what it is. And so the enemy said, man, one of you is betraying me. How do you know? This is what the Lord is teaching us a lot. Every time you deal with human status, if you know who you are, you set the deal. You set the conditions. You are in charge and in control of what's happening. If you know who you are. Okay, it's not the status of people. Okay, it's who's on the inside. Right? It's interesting. Just try this. It's awesome. Yeah, I was listening to some testimony of some people that went in a city in Latin America, and these people were praying for people on the street in the market. So the chief of police shows up to shut them down, right? So people come, and the Lord gives them some prophetic words and words of knowledge about his life. So the guy is like, okay, I'm not shutting it down. So he goes to the respective pastor and says, you know, how come they know so much about me? Who told them? So he ends up to call the chief of police for the whole region. And they pray for him and words of knowledge. And so I'm telling you, who was the authority over that city? The body of Christ. All the other people came for service, right? They came to be prayed for. So this is it. So you know that's how the Lord sets the position very clearly, right? You know exactly who you are. So you enter in a place and the Lord positions you clearly, okay? And, you know, he can show you exactly what's going on with that person. He can tell you how to pray for that, or words of wisdom could come and you can know exactly what to tell or what not to tell, right? But it's, you have to know from the spiritual realm, when somebody looks at that, if you know you are a son of the king, you're above any status of the world, any, absolutely any status. No, we keep talking about favor. You talk to people on the phone. You know, so most of the people is like, oh my gosh, I cannot even understand what he's saying. It's not going to help me. It's like we say, okay, we speak favor. You know what that favor is? You start to realize who you are. You know, and, you know, you talk to that person and says, you know, I know you have a bad headache right now and you cannot help me. The person starts crying. And you start ministering to them, and your problem is solved like this, right? And you say, wow, how come they solve it? So it's very important to know that your weapons are not carnal. They are not natural. That's why you are a king from a different world. That's why you can look into that and knowing who you are, you set the rules. Okay? Every discussion and conditions are set from above. That's how you go in. Okay? Does it make sense? I know most of you experienced or did experience or will experience some of this stuff. And it's very important to know. So, Matthew 28:18. Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth." Question. If all authority has been given to him, how come the devil still does what he does? Good question, Val. Very good. Keep asking. How come the enemy, the problems, the world still has, you know, setting some conditions, oppressing some of the brothers? How come the enemy still can do that? So it says in Galatians 4, while the heir is not of age, he is not different than a slave. So if the heir, the prince, does not know who he is, it doesn't help him too much. Okay? So if the servant comes there and tells the little kid, "Hey, you have to come, you know, crawling to me," the little kid is going to obey because he doesn't know that he's not supposed to obey a servant, right? Lots of the things that come upon the Christians are placed there because of lack of knowledge and the lack of identity of who they are. The fact that, no, you cannot do that to me. You cannot oppress me this way. I'm not supposed to carry this. Okay? Of course, religious spirits and teachings and things that came for years and hundreds of years telling people that, you know, that makes you humble and what doesn't kill you makes you better. You know, that all those sayings that are not in the Bible. Right? This is mentality that came that people can continue to walk with that burden from the enemy. I mean, how, you know, that woman that was hunched, right, had a back, and Jesus said that the Satan oppressed her for 18 years. I mean, nobody would see that. And now probably the rabbis of the time would come and explain to her how God makes her humble. Because she can never hold her head up. So she always looks down, and that's a very humble position. So you should be thankful to God, right? So what Jesus comes and says, no, that's not humility. That's the devil really holding you in that place, and delivers her. And it's like, oh, man, this is good. Yeah, I'm supposed to look like this. All authority has been given to Jesus. So this is interesting because the way the Father wants to do this is exactly as he did with Adam and Eve, right? He placed them there. He trained them. He raised them, so when the temptation comes, they can defeat that, right? They lost it. So said, okay, no, I'm winning, okay? So he sent a second Adam. And the devil did exactly the same thing. If you look at what he tried to do to Jesus in the wilderness, it looked exactly the same as he tried to do, and he did actually to Eve, in the garden. Three things, three temptations, okay? And it's, we're not going to get into that. But again, Jesus won. He said, I'm not bowing to you. There's no way. I have victory over you. You bow to me. So authority is important, but has to be transferred and exercised by the people of God, by his sons. So he has all authority, but you are the one that manifests it. You are the one that goes there and take it over. We mentioned this lots of times about Israel when God said, I got Canaan, it's mine. I took it and I give it to you. Take it. So they could have stayed, and they stayed, unfortunately, at the border for about 40 years. Right? So they kept looking at that. It's like, look at that. All authority. That's so awesome. And it's like still with the sandals in the sand. Right? That's not it. I give it to you. You start taking it. So when you hear what Jesus said is absolutely true, that means there is nothing in your life that's resisting that authority that should stay there. But the Lord is waiting for you to tell it to go. Again, his plan was not like to get a decree and he says, everything gone, I'm the one in charge, right? His plan was, as Jesus had complete authority, that he would train the disciples and send them. Yeah, interesting. This is in the Word. It's not just my opinion. Look what he says there. Matthew 28:18. And Jesus said, all authority has been given to me in heaven and earth. 19. Go, therefore. Now, the word therefore is, because of what I told you before, you do this. Right? So, go, because I have all authority, and take over. And the plan is multiply this. Make disciples, teaching them what I taught you. So I am taking over by spreading, by multiplying Christ's authority in every place I'm going. This is why you are on this earth. This is why you are in the family you are. This is why you are in the job where you are. This is why you are in the house where you are. This is why you are on this earth. To multiply the authority of Christ. Take over what already belongs to him. Now this is awesome. You see somebody receiving the Lord and saying, wow, this is a fruit, praise you, Lord, somebody got saved. But you don't understand that actually it was a captive that belonged to the world, the Lord before. But nobody went there to take that possession back. So salvation, healings, deliverances are things that already belong to the authority of Jesus. You just step in and take it. That's a little bit different perspective, right? As opposed to fighting for it, taking it back, taking to the authority of Jesus. It belongs to him. Very important to know who you are. Same as Israel, one of their biggest challenges was in the beginning, right when they got into Canaan, which was Jericho. I know some of you are at the Jericho land. You know, you're still seeing those walls. And unfortunately, the rest of the land is, it's, you cannot get it because you have to get that one first, right? And it's kind of a weird challenge, right? And I'm not sure exactly what it is in your lives, but lots of times is this kind of a very unusual stronghold. It might be something in your mind, something that you were raised with, is something that you always believe. Could be some incapacity, some sickness, some way of thinking, some relationship, some things in your life that you always had to deal with. It's the Jericho, right? And the Lord says, I gave it to you. See, it's harder, right? Sometimes there's some stubborn things, right, Steve? Some stubborn things like, man, I'm not giving up. And the walls will fall down. They will. They will. And I'm telling you, the whole land is going to open up for you. Go, therefore. John 1:12, but as many as received him, to them he gave them authority. That's exousia. That's the same word as authority. And when it says gave him the right to become sons, he gave him the authority of sons. Sonship is not that you are born in a special category, that you have some special knowledge, a special doctrine. You are born as an heir of God. God wants to share who he is, what he does, what he has with you. Sonship is amazing. You are born into this authority of sons, something that first Adam lost. Now, I mentioned this a couple of weeks ago, the way we understand the kingdom sometimes is like we are thinking we are commanders, or we're learning from the king, and here's the angels, here are the powers, and that's how we fight, and we declare, and we say things, and things are happening. It's not it. And I said that the kingdom is, the living kingdom is part of the king. There is an intimate relationship between all the kingdom and the king and Jesus. Almost everyone is about him. And the best analogy I can give you, it's your body. Think about your body as the kingdom of God. Every cell of your body has your DNA. Okay? There is not a little finger just jumping around and going there to meet people, right? It's you. The little finger, it's you. All the cells of the body are you. All the functions, the organs are you, right? The kingdom of God is Jesus. It's him, okay? So relationship is extremely important when you understand, try to understand how to deal, how to operate in the kingdom of God. Relationship is everything, right? Because the way my hand operates is with the eyes, with the brain, with the legs, with all the functions and the blood. There is not just a hand moving around. So it's the moment you understand that, then you really know that being this one with Jesus stuff that we keep talking about is extremely important, right? Because you cannot operate in the kingdom unless you know him. You know you are one with him. You are acting as Him. You're not just representing Him. Okay, so again, back to the body. This hand is not representing me. This hand is me. Okay? If the hand slaps you, I cannot pretend that I have nothing to do with that unless there is some dysfunctional thing in my brain, right? Well, my hand slapped you, but I have no idea why I did that. Now, do you understand? I cannot just represent the Lord. Says, well, should I pray for this person? Yeah, so should I say this? So, it's almost like it's dysfunctional, right? So this is something that we learn as sons about this oneness. So learning to move in the authority is extremely important to know it's Him moving. Wow, this is pretty good. It's Him slapping the devil. Yeah, do it again, Lord. Boom. Ah, nice. I like that. Twice. Yeah. So it's, you know, when you start this manifestation, lots of us probably experience this, like, man, I heard me talking something, and I was like, wow, that was good. You hear yourself saying something. So it's kind of a letting go of what you thought it is and coming into the one, coming to the oneness. It's Him doing that stuff. So you come into that awareness of, man, it's the Lord. Yeah, that's going to happen. Absolutely, it's going to happen. Here it goes. So when we learn about the authority of the name of Jesus, what we said here is the name of Jesus is not just credentials, but is a realm of existence and of oneness. So when I go in the name of Jesus, and this is a challenge for you, next time you finish your prayer and it says, in the name of Jesus, bless this food, okay? The challenge and what the Holy Spirit is going to do with you is this. It's going to remind you exactly what I'm saying. That the name of Jesus is not just credentials. It's not a formula. It's a place that you are existing in. That moment when you thank for the food is the Lord thanking the Father for the food. That's gonna, it's like, wow, you are thanking for the food right now. Because you are living through this body. Now, my experience at the Sea of Galilee that I mentioned a couple of times, where I was talking to the Lord, and you know, there's still kind of in this separation mode because you go and read the Bible and see, you think about Jesus coming and on this earth and walking on the ground. And so, my very, very happy is, Lord, you look at this. You know, do you remember this place? And He rebuked me, saying that I have no interest in seeing that earth thing. You are my interest. Everything that I'm doing is through you. You are my feet. You are my eyes. You are my hands. It's through you that I go and move and walk there. So it's like, okay, that's a good one. I'll take it. So listen to these verses, John 14:13. And whatever you ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. It kind of makes sense a little bit now, right? Because it's him asking. Of course he'll do it. Remember how he prayed and talked to the Father at the Lazarus tomb? Father, I know you always are listening to me. You always. Wow, that's an awesome son's faith, isn't it? Wow, you always. It's like, man, I kept praying, but I'm kind of have to tune in, and I'm not sure if I'm praying right, and I keep trying to change, and what's the Lord's, what does he want to do? I'm telling you, if you step in the name, you can only pray what he's praying. Yeah. So you will not try to figure it out anymore. Because that's what it is. We put the teaching and the doctrines before the awareness, the revelation. And this is not supposed to be a teaching from the outside. It was supposed to be an anointing from inside. A revelation, a truth that comes in from inside. What you know that you know, that's the truth. Yes, of course he does. Of course he is. Of course he's answering. In that day, John 16, 26, you will ask in my name, and I do not say to you that I will request of the Father on your behalf, for the Father himself loves you. To know his name places us in a position to be in a relationship and love with the King and have spiritual authority. And this place in John 17, 26, I have declared to them your name. And I will declare it that the love with which you love me may be in them and I in them. Wow. The declaration of the name of the Father was for relationship. Okay? We are not learning formulas. We're learning being. We are being in him. This is what it is. I mean, you are or you're not. You cannot learn that. How can you learn the being? Nobody's teaching his eyes how to see. You just realize they do see, right? Maybe if they don't see very well, then you kind of help correcting them, right? But they are born to see. You are born in him with the authority. You are born in there. You have it. So the veil comes off, and you start walking into that. You get in your car. It's like, wow, this is so true. It is him. I am in the name. And this revelation brings the love that he has with you. So the relationship with the Lord is going to be awesome, that moment, okay? So here are places and actions of the name. So I'm just going to go a little bit through this. Mark 16, 17, and these signs will follow those who believe in my name. They will cast out demons. Remember the story we talked about, those people, hey, they cast demons, they heal the sick, and God says, I don't know you. Because they use it as formula. I'm sure formulas work. Yeah, that, lots of principles that work. You know, that's, you know, you learn some things and you do them right, they'll probably work. Because they're principles, right? That's the laws. But that's not what he's doing with you. With you, he says, no, it's a relationship of being in my name. You are in my name. I'm calling you by my name. In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. So next time there is a challenge, you know, is that person at the corner of the street that starts screaming or does some weird stuff, don't think about, oh, man, I have authority. Man, I have to do this. Man, I have to say it. Don't think of it like that. Just say, Lord, I'm so glad I'm in you and you are in me. I'm in your name. And in that name, in that place, the demons are cast out. Now, if I'm in a rush, you know, I have such a joy in his name to quiet or cast out that spirit. If I hear it from the car or something, oh man, that spirit is toasted. If I hear it, I mean, it's like, no, that's a big mistake. You don't scream at my Lord. You don't scream at me. How'd you dare? Right? So you are in the name. So that's one thing. I love this. Acts 15:17. So the rest of mankind may seek the Lord, even all the Gentiles who are called by my name, says the Lord who does all these things. So the Gentiles who are called by my name, they start seeking the Lord. And I mentioned this before, that calling the name of the Lord upon a family, upon a house, upon a person will start changing radically what happens in there if you are in that name, if you walk with that authority. And I know you do. I know you understand this. So the people will start seeking. The hunger for God is going to start in their hearts because the name of the Lord is called upon them. That's going to be interesting. Can you imagine how your family or relatives will look like when you understand this? Because you will understand. Absolutely. That's cool. The experience that the Lord gave me in the last few years, in working in the secular world, is the people are seeking me. I'm not seeking them. I'm not going after saving anybody. The ones that are supposed to be saved, they find me. Right? And that's good. And it's the way he opens up the doors and the connections with the people. That's beyond anything I can ever plan. Way beyond. It's awesome. It's just rich. Every day is a ministry day. Wow, that's pretty cool. I'm thinking sometimes testimonies. And my gosh, where should I start? Because it's alive. It's real. I mean, it's like this. You know, the word of knowledge here, the healing there, the prayer there, the intercession there, speaking into the people's lives there. It's like, man, it's a daily thing. The name of the Lord. You walk in the name of the Lord. Absolutely, all circumstances, everyone that's about around you has anything to do with you is going to start seeking the Lord. This is the ministry of the Son, right? And it's like, oh, yeah. And you know, go there, you know, you want to help someone. And you notice that person is looking at you, and it's like the Lord is very clearly showing you, you have to go to the table, right there. And right there, that's the heart open. And it's just flowing from here, there. And it's, you know, just being. Not really struggling to plan how many people should I talk to today. I mean, it's good. Praise the Lord. There's so many good teachings and ministries that are teaching that. But that's not how you are taught, okay? You are taught from inside out. You are taught who you are, and that makes what you do. And everything around follows that, right? And this is it. You know, it's not against anything. It's just to bless you, okay? That's how we walk. Romans 10:13, for whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So if I walk in the name of the Lord, salvation is right there. Well, I should invite people to church, right? Well, church happens to be right there. Well, I should tell them to pray the sinner's prayer. Well, pray to whom? The Lord is right there. Whoever receives you receives me, he says. Ah, that's another awareness thing, yeah? Like, duh, I should have thought about that. So, people that are really seeking you is because they really want the Lord. And salvation is right there. Right there. Salvation is right there. So they, you know, you don't have to start teaching, preaching, explain to them everything because they are right there. My experience, at least lately, that I'm talking to already saved people. When they get saved, I don't know, before the foundation of the world. And I don't know, the minute before, whenever they believed. The angel showed up the night before and told them, go and look for Val. I don't know when they got saved. But I'm talking to people that already got it. Otherwise, they would not even talk to me. They would not open their hearts. They would not come and say, I never talk to anybody like I'm talking to you. I don't know why I'm doing that. I'm saying this is a coincidence, and I have a strong personality. No, I don't even like some of these people. No, it's not really, oh, man, I'm the nicey, and I love everybody. No, I don't care to talk to some of the people. But if they can see that light and the Father is drawing them to the Son, it's like, saved, done. That's interesting where he takes this ministry tonight. I didn't plan on this. That's good. It's fun. So here is one of the verses I love probably the most, Colossians 3:17. I want you to maybe write down or think about or memorize it. This is awesome, okay? Colossians 3:17. Whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus. This is it, right? You live in that name. You do everything in that name. That's the place. I mean, it's obvious. It doesn't say use the formula, right? Well, I'm sitting on the chair in the name of Jesus. I'm starting to eat the first. Okay, in the name. I'm getting the fork in the name. No, that's not what it means. It's not using formulas like, you know, some religions did it right now. You know, well, you have to hold on. You stand up and say the name of Jesus. No. Everything you do or think is in the name of Jesus. This is it. That's where you live. As he is, so are we. Giving thanks through him to God the Father. So I'm gonna close with this interesting. I think it's pretty extreme. Being the name of Jesus, it's extreme by itself, but this is something real, like John 4 from 50 to 53 talks about some things that Jesus did. I don't know if you know the story. You probably know if I'm telling you about the story. So Jesus, this guy came and was kind of a high in the hierarchy and with a status, right? And says, Jesus, come, my son is dying, right? And Jesus says, go, your son lives. That's it. And what's interesting here is, the man believed the word Jesus spoke to him, started off. As he was going down, his slaves met him, saying his son was living. So it was a pretty long ways he had to ride a horse or go to his house, right? So it's interesting because Jesus said he believed. Can you imagine those hours that he had to keep going and the battle in his mind? I can't imagine. Wow, that's... What if I should have got him? I should have got him. I have money. I have servants. I have horses. Come on. Can you see him texting his wife? It's like Jesus said he's okay, you know? It's like, you left him there? You're not sleeping in the house tonight, you know? That kind of a super fate. Very helpful. Can you imagine all that stuff going through? So he meets the slaves are coming in. And interesting, he inquired and says, hey, your son is doing better. And he wanted to know when. That's an interesting thing. I think I love to look at these personalities of why they are in the Bible. I think that's something that the Father wants, because there are so many probably. And it says in the book, there's so many got healed, he couldn't write in the books. And then no libraries could hold the books, okay? So he asked, what time? Why would you? I mean, it's like, he's good. It doesn't matter. It mattered for him. Because he was given a relationship that was beyond his time. You know why it's harder for you to even talk to other people about what we're talking here? Because sometimes, at least until a few years ago, this was beyond the time. I've been preaching for so many years, and you're talking to people, it's like, man, this is interesting, but I have no idea what to do with this. I think now is the time that people can hear. But for this father, he was beyond his time. Like that centurion, you know, that says, just say a word and my servant will be healed. That's not normal. Jesus was amazed. I mean, what amazes God? This is a good one. You know, what almost surprises God? It's like, wow, really? I haven't found this type of faith. I mean, that was something unusual, even for Jesus, right? Because he was believing ahead of his time. Okay? So if somebody thinks or your thoughts come that you guys are kind of crazy, it's okay. You're ahead of your time, okay? That's fine. Just keep going. Don't slow down. That's okay. So this father was totally... I want to know the time. So they told him the time. And he knew that's exactly when the word was uttered. That's exactly when the word came out. Your son lives. One of the actions of being in his name is that time and space are absolutely relative any longer for you. When the word is coming, you know that wherever that person is changed. Okay? This is in His name. Again, people are going to hear this, but there are so many things that are happening on this earth right now because of these words and words that the Lord is uttering through you and through the sons. Amazing things. Again, there are not enough books and places to write all that, what He's doing now. He said more things will be doing through us, right? When Jesus heard this, he talks about Lazarus. He said, the sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God. So the Son of God may be glorified by it. When he heard he was sick, he then stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. In the name of Jesus, this place has things already done. God calls things from the end at the beginning, right? So time is very interesting thing, right? How is time with God? Maybe I'm the only one asking these questions, but you know, how did God talk to the people and the prophets? Because he's outside time. How would he come and talk to them? Because he had to come at a certain time, right? But he's not in time. For him, everything already finished. Right? Questions? What is that interfaces with time and space from all the kingdom of God? What interfaces with your life as a soul on this earth? Right? Because you are a spiritual being. That means all is done. Read Romans 8. The ones he knew, he sanctified. The ones he sanctified, he glorified. Done. You are living on this earth every day, right? So how God, that's outside time, interfaces with time and space? That's pretty interesting, right? That's homework. You got 3 weeks for this. Okay, that's some of you guys, you have to answer quicker. I'll see you soon, but for the ones that are staying here, you get 3 weeks. So the resurrection of Lazarus, he already had it. So the only reason he stayed longer, okay, was that to make sure that it's not going to be a healing. Because had he gone, the healing would have happened. So he had to make sure there is a resurrection. Why is he saying that this sickness is not unto death? Because Lazarus did die. Probably because the resurrection happened before his death. Because in God's time, that already happened. Okay, all the Einsteins now, they can go to sleep. Exercise. So, this is what the Lord wants to do for what we see in Northwest, in Portland, celebration, local church. We want to start thinking contrary to what these eyes see. And what he wants is to take one area in the places where you absolutely see that's, hey, that's depraving, that's worse, that's the laws are worse, the All this stuff is so bad. It's like it's getting worse by the day. One area that you see that things, with these eyes, you see that things are getting worse, okay? And speak against that, contrary to what you see, okay? So this is, I'm absolutely sure that together, you know, I think Roxy or somebody said about some big worship time that happened here a couple of weeks ago. Some team came from California, our worship team. It was like a whole coliseum full of worship and worshipers. It was like an amazing presence of God. And this is just the beginning. I'm thinking you should go to the streets. Why would it be in an amphitheater? Should go to the streets. Let the glory of God show up right there. Hey, that's a little bit better. Yeah, I mean, if you bring 1,000 people that are worshipers and they love to worship in a place, I mean, that's going to be awesome. But if you take it in the streets, I mean, lots of demons cast out, lots of screaming demons, lots of healings, lots of battles, right? And won by the Lord. So I think that'll be. And that's something that the Lord is doing. So one area, at least one area, where you see things kind of getting worse. Could be schools, could be a city, could be Christians, could be in your body, could be in your family. One thing, one place where you see things are getting worse. And the Lord wants you to speak contrary to that. Okay? And it's going to give you the authority to do it. Okay, let's stand up. And let's do it. Thank you, Father. Praise you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Lord, we thank you that we are in the name of Jesus. We are in the name. As you are, as you speak, as you are, Lord, so are we in this world. And we are looking... We are looking at these circumstances. Oh, thank you, Lord. Oh, wow. There are a bunch of angels that just came in. Thank you, Lord. There are a bunch of angels. They got some work to do. Thank you, Lord. Lord, I thank you for these angels that you just sent now in this place to command. We command the darkness to go. Thank you, Lord. Lord, we are speaking into this neighborhood where you don't see too many people coming and staying here, and they kind of are dull of hearing. They cannot hear the gospel. We speak into these neighborhoods on the streets in all this Northwest, the power of God to break and destroy the power of witchcraft. To destroy the principality of witchcraft and put it under our feet to obey the words of the Lord. Because we want all the people, all the prisoners of war, all the captives to be made free. And hear the word of God. We speak into all these neighborhoods, all the way, Lord. Yes, all this Northwest. All the way into the West Hills, Lord. In all those places, the light to shine in people's houses and in people's hearts. Call your sons home. Thank you, Father. We speak into that and continue to speak right now into every circumstance that you are in. With your family, with your body, with your friends, in things that kind of get worse, that the Lord is rising up in the name of Jesus, changing the circumstance. Let the fire shine in the darkness. Let the light of the fire shine, the pillar of fire. Thank you, Lord. And the cloud cover and lead in the daytime. In spite of the sun. Thank you, Lord. We have your covering. We have your protection even if the world is suffering and the economy might go so bad and people are losing jobs and stuff, Lord, I thank you that we are covered by your grace. Thank you for the clouds, the cover. Thank you that you bless our businesses. You bless our jobs. Thank you, Lord, the increase is continuing happening with everything that you bless your sons with. Thank you, Father. Thank you for the increase of life. Bless you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, continue speaking life, life, life. Yes. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you. Destroying the power of darkness through manifesting light, the light of the gospel. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We bless you, Jesus. Yes. Yes. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Awesome. Thank you. Wow.